فقد قال الله وقوله الحق. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أَمَّنْ مَيْتًا فَأَحْيَيْنَاهُ وَجَعَلْنَا لَهُ نُورًا يَمْشِي بِهِ فِي النَّاسِ كَمَنْ مَثَلُهُ فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ لَيْسَ بِخَارِجٍ مِنْهَا كَذَلِكَ زُيِّنَ لِلْكَافِرِينَ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. صدق الله العلي العظيم. The illumination of the inner light has been our ongoing topic. Tonight is lecture number 5. Alhamdulillah, together we have reached the midpoint of the Ashra, and as all of you know who have been with me since day number 1, the attempt has been to somehow understand the 122nd verse of Surah An'am, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compares those individuals that have hayat and nur, who have light, life and light, to those, of course, who are in utter and absolute darkness. And we have spoken about the concept of life and hayat a couple of nights ago. And we mentioned how it's important that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be found in every aspect of our life. As I mentioned in the beginning of yesterday's discussion, there is no play and no pause button when it comes to Allah. It's not like we turn him off for certain events, we turn him back on for other events. He must be the base of everything that we do. Last night, we examined two words, nur and dhulamat. And we talked in detail about what nur is and its specialty and its characteristics. And of course, by comparison, the characteristics of the word dhulamat. And we did that to get to the point that in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not telling any of us that I've given somebody else the nur that you're looking for within you. That nur, lahu nuran, the ayat says. That this nur is for you. It's inside of you. It's made to do what? To tackle the darkness that we face every single day. With examples yesterday, we mentioned that one of the biggest points of darkness is that it's easily conquered by light. Never once does darkness by itself conquer light. The only time that darkness is chosen over light is when that light is what? Is veiled. When you pin up very thick sheets at 12 o'clock in the day to block the sunlight coming in, it's dark in your room, and then you claim with ignorance that the light doesn't exist. It exists, you veiled that light. You remove the veils, the light shines in. That was discussion from yesterday. In today's discussion, we want to examine that portion of the verse that says, Yamshi bihi finnas. And from tomorrow being Saturday until the day of until the night of Ashura, meaning until Wednesday, we'll then tackle some really important issues. And we'll get to the crux of the verse after going through Hayat and Nur and Dhulamat and Yamshi bihi finnas. Then we actually tackle the main issue of the verse. The reason why Allah even compares these two entities together. The answer is obvious, there is no comparison. It's rhetorical in nature. What is it that Allah wants to get across in this verse? That inshallah will begin tomorrow's discussion. And that will lead us up until Wednesday. Thursday, of course, being only for Imam Hussein. Recite one last salat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, please. It's interesting that Allah says that this individual that was lifeless, فَأَحْيَيْنَاهُ, we gave him life, وَجَعَلْنَا لَهُ نُورًا, then we gave him light. If he stopped there, the verse, it would have been enough. But he didn't. He makes it a point to say, with that light, I want you to what? يَمْشِي بِهِ فِي النَّاسِ, walk with that light amongst the people. And here on the apparent, what is obvious from translation possibly, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes to dictate to us that the deen of Islam is a communal deen, is an ijtima'i deen. It's a deen of the jama'ah, it's a deen of a nation. It should be seen as an ummah, as a nation. not as something that's infiradi or individual by nature. The fact that he said, look, I gave you your light, you can do what you want with that light, you can shine yourself, whatever you want. No, he made it a point to say, take that light and take that life and walk with the people. Walk amongst the people. Be with the people. Don't close yourself out in a room. Don't hide yourself out in a basement. Don't climb the top of the mountain and only do ibadah there. No, you have to be bain mardum. You have to be with the people, amongst the people, traveling with the people, shining your light for the people. And all this points to the fact that we have to revive the communal aspect of the deen. Revive the idea of a community. The Quran, up and down the Quran, talks about the idea that this idea of enjoining the good and forbidding the evil, of course, as we know, we've learned from, of course, Sunday school, is a wajib, part of the what? Furu' al-Din, one of the two of the ten, actually. But in tonight's discussion, we're going to look at this idea of the forgotten obligation. We've allowed the West to kind of teach us that the only person that matters is the person in the mirror. And we've adopted a very individual approach to the deen to the point where we've forgotten about each other. And Islam was never about the individual. Islam was always about the jama'ah and the nation and the community at large. When in Surah Ali Imran, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that you are what? You are the greatest nation. كُنْتُمْ خَيْرٌ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرَجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. From all the people, you are the greatest nation. There's nothing better than you. You are the best out there. And right away he defines what is it that makes you the best. It's not your salat, it's not your hajj, it's not your khums. No, he says it's the fact that what? تَعْمَرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْحَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَتُؤْمَنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. What makes you the best is that you look out for each other. You push each other towards good, you repel the evil from each other, and all of you collectively, تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. You believe in Allah. Those are the ingredients that makes you the best nation out there. You know, there's a lot of beautiful aspects of this Western civilization. There really is. I'm not one of those that bashes the West. I think there are things that are very Islamic that we find in this part of the world that we don't find even in those quote-unquote Islamic countries. For example, one of them is this value for life, value for human life. I've seen it, and so have you, in the practical sense that when an individual, when one life is saved, they celebrate like all of humanity is saved. And they try to pour in as much as they can to save one life. Now, the price tag of lives is not my discussion. A lot of you will argue, and it's a legitimate argue, the reaction that certain lives are lost in one part of the world, whereas those same amount of kids are lost, let's say, in Bahrain and Yemen, and there's zero reaction. That's not my discussion. My talk is that they will do everything they can, and specifically, let's say, in the medical health field, to do everything they can to save the patient. When, for example, if I can share with you a personal story, when my son was born, as many of you know, he was born very, very premature. He was in a hurry to come into this world. So he arrived 3 months before he should have. A pound and a half, he fit inside of my hand. He spent 110 days in the ICU at Sunnybrook. And we had, my wife and I, we had a little personal room, a little personal pod, and he was in there in his incubator. And there must have been massive machines worth millions of dollars all around him, attached to him in some sort of probe and somewhere, just keeping the kid alive. And we would, of course, after dropping our girls off to school, we would go every morning there about 9 a.m. or so. We walk in, and certain mornings, of course, we would see that the nurse that was assigned to my son on that day would actually be holding him close to her skin and humming some lullabies and rocking him on the rocking chair, doing things that were above and beyond the job description. She was there to read some numbers. She was there to chart the progress. She was there to administer medication. But I remember specifically one morning walking in and seeing this nurse, you know, holding and cuddling with my son, and she would say, "I'm sorry, I don't mean to, you know, step on your toes, but I felt that he was a little bit uneasy this morning and he needed some human touch. So I hope you don't mind, but I took it upon myself to hold him and keep him warm until I gave him to you." Like, that's beautiful. It's humanity at its essence. She didn't have to do that. And there was one nurse assigned to my son, one nurse assigned to my son 12 hours a day. The shift would change, and a second nurse would come. And every day as we celebrated his numbers going up, they would celebrate with us. When we would cry over emotion, they would cry with us. When we left the hospital, the entire staff accompanied us to the car, put us inside the car seat, and said goodbye to him. When we go for checkups, they all come to see how is Hassan doing. How is Hassan doing? Oh my God, he's a big boy now, mashallah. All of that can be found in this civilization. Sometimes not on that part of the world. So there is a lot of beauty in this part of the world. But there are also some dangers in this part of the world. There are certain things in this society that's being shoved down our throats, and we are taking it, unfortunately. And one of them is this individualism idea. To mind your own business, to live your life, to each his own, don't worry about the guy beside you. If somebody is drowning, thank God that you know how to swim and keep moving. Don't worry about the guy beside you. Even in our deen, so long as me and Allah are good, Maulana, who cares about what anything else thinks? Who cares if my brother is suffering, or my neighbor is suffering, or the guy I know is suffering? No, me and God are good, that's all that matters. I keep up with my salat, I fast in the month of Ramadan, I've done my hajj, alhamdulillah, I'm good. Imam Sadiq, alayhi salatu wasalam, in his book of Misbah al-Sharia, the very first discussion in that book is on ubudiyah, subservience to Allah. And in there he says, if we wish to even tread the path of being a subservient or being subservient to Allah, we must examine four different relationships in our life. One is obviously between me and Allah, that's one. The second is between me and other individuals, family, community, friends, your neighbors, etc., etc. Number three is me and my amal, how do I see my deeds? And number four, me and the dunya. Look at the beautiful example that Imam Sadiq gives. It's not enough that you and Allah are good and doesn't matter how I am with my family or with my community, no. We have to begin to revive this idea that we are a family. The Prophet says, on a physical human body, if one area hurts, everything else comes and tries to rescue that from the pain. And that's how my Muslim ummah should be. That if somebody bleeds and somebody is hurting and somebody is drowning, we should put all of our efforts in to save that individual. The example he's given always is a boat. Imagine you are in a boat with X amount of people in the middle of the deepest part of the ocean, and one person on your boat has an axe, and slowly but surely, he's making a hole in the boat. Now you have one of two options, right? You can say, oh, look what he's doing. It's okay, mind your own business. He's busy putting a hole in the boat. Or you could say, look, can you please stop doing that? If that hole is big enough, enough water gets in, the boat will sink, you'll sink, and we'll sink with you. He says the boat is Islam and those inside the boat are the Muslims. We have to worry about the image of the deen. We have to worry about the grave of those around us. We have to revive the idea that we are a nation, an ummah, a family. If a person you know is bleeding, you should also bleed with that person. This idea that Allah said, I gave you hayat, I gave you nur, not just for yourself. Take that flashlight and enlighten the path of those around you. And walk with the people. Don't hide, don't avoid, don't be a stranger. Be with the people, in the middle of the people. The very first thing the Prophet of Allah did when he arrived in Medina was he set up a community. He built a mosque, he built homes around that mosque, such that one door was between your house and the masjid. Because there's strength in numbers, there's strength in community. But we've kind of forgotten all of that. We tell ourselves that, Milana, I'm too busy worrying about my own grave, keeping my head above water. I have to now worry about this person and that person. Yes, you do. Because part of your salvation is the salvation of others as well. And that's the part that we don't get. We know there are people that we know that are suffering right now, going through a lot of turmoil. Maybe even turmoil that we can help and fix. But we refuse to get involved. Troubled marriages, problems with children and parents, individual who now has adopted a very bad habit. You know that you have his ear. You know that everything you say, he'll listen to. But you choose to not get involved. I'm not touching that with a pole, I'm sorry. No way. Let him do what he wants to do. A lot of my youth out there, you're watching some of your friends on social media post things that you know he's making a turn away from the path. But you don't dare say anything for several reasons. Number one is we just don't do that, Milana. We don't call each other out. I'm sorry. That's not what we do. But more importantly is that if I call him out, he's going to flip around and call me out. So you have the gall to be Captain Islam? You have the gall to sit there and judge me? You're going to sit there and call me out, bro? Do you remember that Friday that we went here and there and you did this and this? Did you forget all that? You became Mr. Holy than now all of a sudden and we don't want to hear it? So what do? Let him be, Moana, let him be. That's not what this verse is talking about. This verse is saying, take that light that Allah gave you and look for those in darkness and pull them out and pick them up off the ground. Say, look, you don't need to trip anymore. I've got the light for you now. Let's walk together. You know, these beautiful little stories we hear from the life of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi salatu wasalam. And there's a lot to say tonight. There's always a lot to say, and I'm going to go fast like I usually do. Inshallah, you can pick up the speed. We know that there was a moment where Imam Ali was walking with one of his friends, and they were walking home one day. It's a very touching story for me, a very simple, short story, but it really means a lot to me, maybe for all of you as well. I'm sure you've heard it several times. And he's accompanying this individual, our Mawla is, and they're busy in conversation, so busy that they pass by Imam Ali's house and get to the man's house, who lived a little bit further away from Imam Ali. And the man gets to his house, and all of a sudden he realizes that we passed by Imam Ali's house several minutes ago. He said, Mawla, I'm sorry. I got caught up in the conversation. We should have dropped you off first, and I should have came. You came all this way, and I had to walk all the way back. And Imam Ali knew exactly what was going on. And he says one beautiful statement to that individual. He says, a true friend is one who accompanies his friend to his final destination together. Doesn't leave him high and dry and say, find your own way, I'm home now. And so in this concept, we have to talk about two major components. One is inside our homes, one is inside the circle of our influence. Crucial discussions. There's a saying, they have these nice statements sometimes, think globally, act locally, right? It's a very famous statement. Think globally, act locally. We're worried about climate change. We see these glaciers melting in the North Pole. We see hailstorms in Mecca. We see, let's say, snow in Dubai. We're like, oh my God, this weather, this planet's going upside down. It's going crazy. We're ruining that. How could that happen? Let's support it on a global scale, but inside your home, you don't compost your food, for example. You don't have a recycle bin. You're not worried about where paper goes or plastic goes. You don't bring, let's say, your own mug for chai to JCC every single night. You're okay with using a plastic styrofoam cup every morning and throwing it out, but you're worried sick about climate change globally. Think globally, but act locally. Worried about climate change? Teach your kids about compost and recycle bins. Worried about climate change? Bring your own thermos to JCC. Worried about climate change globally? Bring your own plates when it comes to the month of Ramadan. Think globally, act locally. All of us are worried about what our future will be, Molana. Our future doesn't look bright. Homes are burning, divorce rates are up, kids are off the path. This global movement on the Ummah, India, Africa, Pakistan, Toronto, it doesn't matter. It's all one small village now. What's gonna happen? Think globally, act locally. What's happening in your home? And tonight I'm bound to upset one group of people, and that's okay. And that's the men in this hall. Because the reality is that our homes are absolutely burning, the divorce rates are absolutely up, and the children are absolutely having a distance away from their father, from their parents. And part of that is because we've lost our roles inside of the family. Or we accept only half the role and we drop the other half. The reality is, and my sisters have to accept this, it's not me, it's a Sharia, inside of a family structure, an individual family structure, nuclear family structure, the leader of that house is the father and the husband. That wilayat is given to the man. The steering wheel for the car is given to the man. You, in this hall, looking at me right now, are the wali of your house. Either in the form of a father or a husband or both. And all of you know that. So yeah, I'm the man in the house, I know. I have my own chair, I have my own place, this is my chair, I'm the man. And with that wilayat, we believe sometimes, and the stories I hear all of you hear, is that we take that wilayat and we lead with an iron fist on our family. Because that's what we believe the deen wants from us. To keep everybody in check. It's not what the deen wants from you. If you are easily accepting that wilayat, and you should be, you should also accept the responsibility. And that wali in the house, meaning you and me as well, I'm a father and I'm also a husband. That wilayat includes the idea that we are responsible for taking our families to Jannah. We as men inside the homes are responsible for taking my family to heaven. Not me, I'll give you supporting verses of the Quran. How many times have I heard individuals come and say, Mawlana, you know, for the past 6-7 years, I spend the day of Ashura in Karbala, mashallah. I made a mannat, I made a niyat, I made intentions, and I did it, and I don't miss a single Ashura in Karbala, mashallah. This is my 6th year, my 7th year, I've been to 8 hajjis, I've done the walk 4 or 5 times, mashallah, I've been to Sham, everything, blah, blah, blah. If I ask you, do you go alone? Yeah, I go alone. What about your wife? She walks too slow, Malana. Lots of luggage, Malana. There's 1,000 issues, Malana. You know, it's just, this is my time with my imam. It's between me and my imam. And while you're elevating towards your imam by yourself, you're leaving your family behind. And it reminds me of a very famous story that a qafila comes back from Hajj and visits Imam Sadiq, alayhi salatu wasalam. And the qafila comes, and it was common back then. You go see the imam of your time after Hajj. And the qafila would come, they come back from a Hajj, they would of course accept the Mubarak from the imam, the congratulations from the imam, mashallah, I'll accept your Hajj. They would tell about their experience, and the man in the qafila, one of them would say, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, there was one man in the qafila, mashallah, he was Mr. Piety. He would never leave the side of the Kaaba. Day in and day out, ibadat upon ibadat, dua upon dua, every salat on awwal waqt, ba jama'at, right in front of the Kaaba, touch the Kaaba, all this type of thing, everything, maqam Ibrahim, everything. And the imam is listening to this individual describe this one man's hajj. And he says to that man, the imam, after he's done describing this man's hajj, the imam asks this individual, did this man come alone to hajj or was he with his family? He said, no, his whole family came to hajj. And then the imam asked even a more delicate question, that while this man was sitting beside the Kaaba day in and day out, morning and night and afternoon, worshiping, who was looking after the affairs of the family during this trip? Well, we all kind of collectively did it together. Our women looked after his wife, our kids after his kids, you know, to make sure that he wasn't disturbed. And then the imam says something very devastating to them. They says that your hajj was more accepted than his was. It's a matter of fulfilling responsibility. And part of the reason why our homes are burning, and I ask you please, you've been with me for 5 nights, you've been very, very loving to me, you've been very, very courageous with me and giving me your feedback, and I don't want you to lose me tonight, but part of the problem in our homes is that today's man is not today's man anymore. We have dumped everything on our women. From the affairs domestically, from cleaning the place, to cooking the place, to raising the kids, to Quran class, to namaz, to madrasa, to everything. And all I need to do is work my 8 hours, pay my Enbridge bill, and everything is good, Malana. And meanwhile, this woman is dying under the pressure. And we wonder why the walls are closing in. Because we have not quite grasped the idea that I need to take my family to Jannah. Hadith says that when you wake up for Fajr, wake up the family. Those individuals who are fasting, who are praying in your house, wake them up. As if there is a fire in your house. That's how much urgency there is. I tapped her once, well, she didn't move, so I just prayed and went back to sleep. No, wake her up. Be worried about the grave of your children. Because nobody will ask you, did you maintain your mortgage payments in your grave? Everybody will ask you that I gave you a spouse, I gave you children. As the man of the house, did you take that family to Jannah or not? Did you leave them behind? Or worse yet, did you allow your wife to fly towards Allah? And you're like, I'm good here. I don't want to fly towards Allah like you do. Because the Quran says what? In Surah Tahrim, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا. Very carefully. O you who believe, the mu'mineen, all of you in this room, protect yourselves and your family from the fire. That fire could be in this dunya, that fire could be in the akhirah. Doesn't matter. Any form of fire, the man is there to protect his family from the fire. Not run from the house and let the house burn down. Not run from the house and let the wife grab the extinguisher and take that fire out. That's your job. If you want to accept the walayat and accept that home-cooked meal and accept that chai when you come home, accept that. At the same time, accept the responsibility of taking your family, your wife, to Jannah. If that means you take her to go say your salams to Aba Abdullah Hussein, then take her with you one time. If that means that you see that she's pushing your 9-year-old daughter, that now it's wajib on you, my dear, to praise namaz. Did you pray namaz? Did you pray namaz? Did you pray namaz? And she looks at Baba and says, isn't it wajib on Baba as well? Yamshi bihi finnas begins at home. Allah gave you that light. Allah gave you the walayat. For reasons I don't want to discuss, it's not my topic. But we are the leaders of the house. And there are rights over us that the wife has to fulfill, and she is or she isn't, that's her discussion. I'm not here to talk about her tonight. I'm here to talk about us, and I'm with you. I equally need to pick up my game when it comes to me as a husband and as a father. Because the du'as of the prophets, if you look at the du'a of Nabi Ibrahim in Surah Ibrahim, look at what he's talking about. He says, Allah, Rabbi ij'alni muqima salat wa min dhurriyati. Make me the one who establishes salat and make my children the ones who also establish salat. I don't want it to be that I send my children back to you, Allah, in the akhirat. They don't have a glimpse and any idea what the deen is. We need to step up our game as men in this era, in this time right now. You know, we teach our daughters, right, from when they were young. We prep them for when they get married. Do we not? That look, one day, at least our wives do, right? Look, one day you're going to be a wife. You're going to be a daughter-in-law, you're going to be a sister-in-law. Make sure when you go to that house that you don't cause ruckus, that you're patient, that you work with your mother-in-law, that you work with your sister-in-laws, that you make sure that you keep your husband happy, that you show modesty, and you have haya, and you have some iffat, and you don't talk to non-mahram, and you don't sit this way, you don't dress this way, you don't speak this way. It's not munasib or appropriate for a girl to talk like that. And all of that from 9, 10, 12, 14, 18, 20, even the night before she gets married, all of that is reminded. Look, don't forget, don't forget, don't forget. Do we ever have a conversation with any of our sons that you're going to leave the house one day? Give him responsibility. Ask him, what are you studying? Do you have any of the tools to take your wife and rent a house or buy a house in this difficult market and carry your mortgage for X amount of years? Or will daddy sell you out time and time again? So while you're teaching your daughter to be modest, teach the same modesty to your son as well. While you're teaching the modesty to your daughter to don't look at this non-mahram, don't sit beside him, for example, teach the boy as well. Don't look at her this way. Don't talk to her this way. Don't touch her in this way. All these things have to be balanced, and they're not. They're very imbalanced. We're not producing men from our sons. We're not. Wake him up on a Saturday morning. Junior, go cut the lawn. Junior, go change the light bulb. Learn how to change a flat tire. Learn how to balance your books. Come and help me run the finances of the home. Come and build your spirituality such that you have enough to take yourself and your family with you. The example I'll give you is water. It's a water. The person has one jug of water that's, let's say, is 2 liters, and one jug is 10 liters. And the man has a certain amount of cups, and he's out there giving water to his family. And all he has is 2 liters. 2 liters goes by very quickly. And he keeps giving water until his jug is empty, and his kids are what? His kids are still thirsty. Baba, I'm still thirsty. It's all the water I have, I'm sorry. But I'm still thirsty, Baba. I'm sorry, that's all I have. As opposed to someone who has 10 liters, 20 liters, 50 liters. The thirstier you are, the more water I'll give you. Your thirst will run out, my water won't run out. And we begin that process from when the kid is 10, 12, 14, 18. Put it in his head, you are the leader of your family. Not just so you can walk around and have your own chair and have your own remote, it's Baba's time to watch TV. No, with that comes what? Did you pray Salat? Have you read Quran? Come with me, there's no choice. I'm going to the masjid, you're coming with me. You're 10 years old, you don't have a say yet, I'm sorry. You come with me. You have questions about the deen? Ask me, I'm your father. If I don't have the answer, I'll get it for you. No problem, but ask me. We live in an era now where children are bringing their fathers to the mosque. Where kids are coming to me and saying, can you please explain to my father the benefit of salat? When the adhan is going on, I ask the son to please come in and pray salat. He goes, Mana, I would love to ask my father who's smoking outside to come in as well, if you don't mind. Sure. Quran says you are responsible to protect yourself and your family from the fire. These families are burning, and part of it, and I say part of it, it's not everything. A lot of you are amazing in your homes, true leaders. And if your family is not accepting your wilayat, that's their jihad and their struggle. But establish the fact that you are the leader of that house. Think globally, act locally. If you're worried about the ummah at large, worry about your ummah inside your house. Ask yourself, does my government inside my house, inside my four walls that I can control, does that government reflect Allah's government? Meaning, if what is halal in my house is halal in Allah's house. What's haram in my house is haram in Allah's house. Or is it the fact that, oh, okay, I'm sometimes lenient. I know Allah says haram, but it's okay, I let her do it, Mulana. We must be able to understand yamshi bihi finnas begins at home. We must revive our manhood. Teach your boys to be men. We're forced sometimes to take these kids to camp up north, have gender-segregated discussions, and talk to the men about being men. Being a man isn't, yeah, yeah, that's not being a man. It's not. I'm sorry. Being a man is being a responsible individual, having a control of your emotion, always taking the higher road, always being the mature one. Even in a conversation with your wife, if she's losing her mind and being emotional, then you also kind of what? Take a back seat and calm down. When she calms down, then you have an intellectual conversation. Not that, oh, you want to show me your ignorance? I'll show you my ignorance. It's not how the Ahlul Bayt worked. The Ahlul Bayt, time and time again, they were never a reflection of the akhlaq of the person in front of them. They were always their own reflection, and they went around and they produced that reflection to anybody they could. If the person was jahil in front of them, they'd become the alim in front of them. If the person was spewing fire, they would shower them with water and extinguish that fire. And we need that as men. And I'm with you. I'm only a man because I have a few hairs on my face. I need to also up my game as well. This is a conversation that we have together. But there's reasons why a lot of our sisters are depressed, anxious, stressed out. Nothing in their world seems like it's worth it. They can't even get out of bed sometimes. They can't even muster up the energy to come to a majlis of Imam Hussein. Is there anything we can do as men in that house to lighten that load? Is it possible that maybe tonight I'll say, you know what? You go to the majlis, I'll stay home and watch the kids. And I know it's going to be a very interesting drive home tonight, and I'm sorry about that. I don't mean to cause problems. But this is the deen talking, not me talking. The deen has given you the walayat. Take that walayat as a responsibility, not as a means to what? To govern with an iron fist. The famous story, and I'll end with this discussion, the famous story of Sa'ad from the Jung of Ahad is one that all of you know. Sa'ad was a man who gave his life during the war of Ahad. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. As you know, the Prophet of Allah, of course, was part of the process of giving him ghusl. The Prophet of Allah read his talqeen, his salatul mayyit, buried him, everything. They went to Sa'ad's mother for condolences. And they would say to the mother, congratulations, mashallah, your son is in heaven. And the Prophet would say, wait a second, how are you saying this? Ya Rasulullah, talqeen read by you, salatul mayyit read by you, ghusl given by you, buried by your hands. He was a man in Ahad. How can he not? Of course, he wasn't a shaheed. Did not die on the Maidan or the battlefield itself. He died a little bit after the war of Ahad. How can it not be that, of course, that he's not, of course, in heaven? And the Prophet would say that if you could hear what I'm hearing now, I hear the punishment in his grave. Why? Because while Sa'ad was perhaps with me in Ahad, he was a zalim and an oppressor in his home. Didn't fulfill his responsibility as a man. And we need to think about these things. And understand that, yes, that leadership is given to you, but begin to prep your sons to be tomorrow's leaders, to take their family towards Jannah, inshallah. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Point number two about yamshi bihi finnas is a circle of influence. And the circle of influence is that circle in our life where individuals exist in that circle that naturally influence us. And I really want my youth in this audience to really focus on this discussion. This is the last discussion, we move towards Masaib after that. We have pages and pages and pages of traditions in our books that talk about the concept of those individuals who influence us in our life, friendship in our life, people that we spend our time with outside of the family. There are discussions about who you should befriend, those that you should not befriend, talking about the fact that a group of friends are actually multiple bodies attached to one soul. Individuals, we talk about the fact that you will what eventually accept the deen and the lifestyle of the people you hang out with. Sayings that all of you heard, that show me a man's friends, I'll show you his future. All these things are there. The deen also has captured this discussion. And it is a highly important discussion. Because the reality is, a lot of the deviation that we see inside of our youth today, a lot of the fact that they choose that dhulamat over that nur is not them, it's the circle around them. I tell you, I speak to a lot of these youth individually. I have great conversations, inspiring conversations with some of the best youth out there in this city, sometimes in this very community, great gems of youth when they're alone with me. Put them in their group, for some reason they change. Everything about them changes. The way they walk changes, where they sit changes. How they grow their hair changes, how they shave their hair changes, what they wear changes, how they speak changes, their language speaks, everything. It's not them, it's the circle around them. You exit that, you take that kid out of that circle, and once again, he's that gem. Understand the influence that the people around you have, and attach yourself with those who have the light. Attach yourself with those that you know that if I fall into darkness tomorrow, this brother has my back. If you look at, for example, the verse in Surah Ankabut, very beautiful story. It says, "What إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لِنُدْخِلَنَّهُمْ فِي الصَّالِحِينَ." That if you have iman and you do amal salih, Allah says that we will place you amongst the salihin. Very quickly, this verse, it's sha'an nuzul. The story behind its revelation is that, as I mentioned a few nights ago, Surah Ankabut is a Makki surah. Majority of the verses, including this one, are revealed in the later stage of the Meccan portion of his prophethood. And you know, the last 2 or 3 years in Mecca were very hard on the holy prophets. Shibe Abu Talib, sanctions, banishment from his city, etc., etc. Very difficult before, of course, his migration to Medina. When they were banished from Mecca and placed inside the valley of Abu Talib, where, of course, as you know, the resources were scarce, that was a very difficult time for not only the Prophet of Allah, but also his followers. Part of his followers, as I mentioned last night, were young people. Young guys would attach themselves to the Holy Prophet. And they would oftentimes approach the Holy Prophet and says, "Ya Rasulullah, you know, Mecca is our home city. That's our town. Born and raised in Mecca. Played in the streets of Mecca. We have childhood friends in Mecca right now. There are boys in Mecca. Haven't what said yes or said labbaik to your call. That tawfiq, that inspiration isn't there yet. We have, alhamdulillah. But now this separation is there and we miss them. And here, is it okay if we kind of, you know, keep that friendship with them, even though they're the mushrikeen and we, of course, are the muslimeen? If not, then what do we do? How do we handle this idea? Because we miss them." And then this verse was revealed. A beautiful verse. A verse for those of you in this audience, and I know there are a lot of my youth in this audience, who belong to a group, who have their boys, who have their clique, and it's very difficult for them to exit from that group. They know what they're doing is wrong, they know what they're doing is haram, I know absolutely what they're doing, Molana, but honestly, I can't leave my group. The verse says that for those who have iman and amal salih, Allah says that we will place you amongst the salihin. Meaning what? That you don't need to worry about your circle of friends. If you uphold your iman and uphold your good deeds, Allah says, "I'll take care of your friendships for you. I'll place you amongst circles that you never thought could be circles for you. I'll place you with people who are like-minded, who have the same purpose that you do. If you want to be God conscious and your boys around you don't have any inclination towards God, then exit that. Don't sell your soul out. I'll place you in a circle that's just like you, who want more for you in the akhirat than they want for themselves. Just don't sell your soul out. Don't quiet that conscience, that fitrat inside of you that's telling you it's wrong, it's wrong, it's wrong, it's wrong. Don't turn that off. It's not worth it." Imam Ali says, your soul, your value, your qadr is what? Is Jannah, is heaven. Don't sell it for anything less than that. And a lot of our youth today do that. They're stuck sometimes because they believe if I exit this group, I have nobody. I'll be isolated, I'll be alienated, I'll be bullied on social media, all sorts of posts and tweets and messages, you're soft, what happened to you, blah, 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 this and that, and we don't want to handle that, so we'll quiet the conscience, we'll remove the thud from my parents, and I'll continue to go down this path of destruction, because what? They're my brothers, Milana. They make me feel like I belong to them. I know that they commit crimes, I know that they commit sin, but if I ask him to be at my door at 3 a.m., at 3:01, he's at my door. And that's enough for me. I'll put up with the crime and the sin. I'll say, sorry to God later, but I don't want to break this brotherhood. And what we're doing is that we're allowing ourselves to dictate what that circle is. And please be very careful. Surah Fussilat describes a conversation between those who are about to enter the hellfire in the hereafter and other individuals. When those other individuals ask the potential or the eventual inmates of hell that what happened, why are you entering the hellfire? They blame one person in this world. They say, woe unto me, ya laytani lam attakhiz fulanan khalila. If only I didn't take so-and-so as my friend and my boy, I wouldn't be in this predicament today. Of all the things to blame, of everything to blame, I was born in the West, raised in the West, I live in a small town, my parents weren't very religious, blah, 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 this and that. Of all the things to blame, the Quran reveals, not me, the Quran is saying that this person will say that this Khalil, this friend of mine, he allowed me to become an eventual inmate of hell. That's the power of influence. Oh, but Mawlana, I'm in that group so I can save them, mashallah. Fantastic, Captain Islam, absolutely. It's great. If I leave that group, the group will crumble, Mawlana. I'm the voice. Yeah, you're the voice. Be careful. I've seen too many times. I've had too many 3 a.m. Tim Hortons conversations with too many kids in this beautiful city, where they are out to save a kid from drowning, save a kid from drowning, save a kid from drowning, and they end up drowning themselves. And there comes a moment, and I'm sorry, you have to be selfish about your journey. What about akhlaq? I'm not telling you to say good luck in hell, guys. No, that's not what I'm saying. There's a way to do it, but first make it in your mind that who I'm around, I know in the heart of my hearts, these guys are bad news. They're not getting me anywhere. They don't remind me of Allah. They don't pull me on the path. They don't encourage me. I'm going to go to JCC. There's a good speaker this year. Don't go to the Afghan Center. Come here instead. You want those kind of friends. Not, it's okay. We'll go on Ashura. Don't worry. There's still a lot of days left. No, not like that. You want somebody who pulls you towards good, who, like I said, is worried about your akhirat the exact same way he's worried about his akhirat. And I ask you, my boys, my youth in the audience, do you have one friend like that? Because Imam Ali says if you have made one friend like that, you are successful in this dunya. One, that's all it takes. Yamshi bihi finnas is that man who has that light. Attach yourself to that one individual who's shining the path on yours. Don't sell yourself short. Don't be worried about the fact, what's going to happen. Don't worry. لِنُدْخِلَنَّهُمْ فِي الصَّالِحِينَ. Let God take care of that for you. Provided what? إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Don't sell your soul out, guys. Don't adopt habits you know is wrong. Don't go down a path you know is destructive. Don't do all that. Your parents have worked too hard to make sure you are a good head on your shoulders for you to throw it away for a circle that doesn't care about themselves and certainly about you. Think about these things. Stop and wonder, what am I doing? Is it worth it? And I asked my parents, and you young guys won't like me tonight. I asked my parents, a lot of you are worried and obsessed with the friends that your children have. I ask you to be obsessed with that. Don't bring them home, interview them, and ask them for their, you know, give me your lineage and give me your grandfather's name and give me your blood type. And no, not like that. But yes, find out where he's going. Find out who he's with. Because it is that influence that shuts off every other voice, even your own as parents, and turns on that voice of those friends. And you'll jump from circle to circle to circle to circle until you find that circle of friends that you can sit there and you can watch a game with, you can travel with, and you can sit there and you can have a night of a'mal with as well. You'll find that circle. Just don't sell yourself out. You'll find that circle who will stop and say, bro, do you really think you should have posted that? Do you really think that you should have done that or did this? It's not like you. What's going on with you? A person who is there for you. Remember, Imam Ali says, two tests for a friend. Number one is behind your back. Number two is in your time of need. The problem is that we have what? We have quantified our friendships, not qualified our friendships. Because this West will tell you that a friendship level is at the body level, whereas Islam says it's at the soul level. And that's what I want you to do. Quote unquote, the soulmate discussion was a discussion in Islam a long time ago. I want my youth, ask yourself, the circle I'm with right now, are those yamshi bihi fin nas or not? I ask my fathers and my husband, I ask myself, let's lead our families to Jannah. Let's relieve the pressure off of our wives and our mothers. Let's regain our manhood. Let's train our sons to be tomorrow's men, inshallah. Because the reality is, if you look at Imam Hussein's circle of influence, he had the best of the best around him. No other ashab that any individual had. Not the Prophet of Allah, not Amir al-Mu'mineen, not anybody else. And the one statement that I always love reciting every single year when it comes to these amazing companions of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn is that while other imams were calling their companions to come towards them, Imam Hussein is that imam that would tell them to go away from me. Go away from me. I blow out the candle in the middle of the night. They don't want your head on a spear, they want mine. They want to shed my blood. There's a valley, there's a path between those two mountains. Walk towards those two mountains. Go back to your families. Live your life. Jannah for you is already there. I've accepted your bay'at. And they would say things like, Aba Abdullah, if we leave you now, how can we answer Sayyidah Fatima on the Day of Judgment? If we have to taste death anyways, what better way to taste death than beside you, Abu Abdullah? If they cut us into pieces and trample our body and put us back to life and trample our body, and 1,000 times we would say, Labbaik, Ya Hussein, Labbaik, Ya Hussein. That was his circle of influence. And that test I talked about of Amir al-Mu'mineen, that in that time of need, when he had that time of need, that test was given to who? The champion of all these companions, Habib ibn Mudahir. A childhood friend of Imam Hussein. These two went back in Medina to their childhood days. When Imam Hussein was in Karbala, Habib of course was in Kufa under immense house arrest. The environment in Kufa was very, very tense. If the companions of Imam Hussein weren't in jail, they were highly, highly watched. Surveillance everywhere. Arrival in Karbala happens the 6th of Muharram, the 7th of Muharram, the 8th of Muharram. Bibi Zainab now is watching what? Armies upon armies coming from Kufa, setting up shop across from them. In the hundreds, in the hundreds, in the hundreds. And she's watching this, and she's watching the fact that not one person now has come from Medina, from Mecca, from Basra, nowhere. And she approaches Imam Hussein and says, Bhaiya, is there nobody that we can call to come and assist us in this mission? And that's when Imam Hussein writes this letter to Habib. Imagine, sometimes we think about why Imam Hussein was so mazloom. We think about the thirst and the blood and the physical scars. Maybe those were all there. But the fact that the Imam of the time, the Hujjat of Allah, the rightful successor of the Prophet's kingdom, had to write a letter for someone to come and help him, perhaps is the biggest mazlumiyat of Imam Hussein. Habib is sitting in his home in Kufa. And our books tell us that he is in his home with his wife. There's a knock on his door. In Kufa, of course, you check who it is. Habib, now, of course, very cautiously approaches the door. The knock happens a few more times. And behind the door, without opening, he asks, who is it behind the door? And from behind the door, the answer comes, Ana Safir al-Hussein. I am the messenger of Hussein. Habib hears Hussein, opens the door. He presents to him a letter. Habib opens the letter, his face drops. His wife is watching every reaction on his face. The letter begins by saying, Min Hussein ibn Ali ila rajulun faqih Habib ibn Mubahir. One version in history says that the letter started off by saying, Min Hussein gharib ila rajulun faqih. This letter is from Hussein to Habib. He begins to read this letter. Tears go down his face. Sweat begins on his entire face turns white. His wife is watching him, worried. What is it, Habib? What is it, Habib? What is it, Habib? It's a letter from my Mawla Hussein. Saying what? They've reached Karbala, surrounded by the enemy. He has the women of Rasulullah with him. He's asking me to come and help him. And there seems to be hesitation. And either one version of the story says that he was testing his wife, or the other version says that he legitimately didn't know what to do with his wife after he left. So there was hesitation. Until his wife says to him, Habib, your Mawla Hussein writes a letter to you, and you hesitate. What is the hesitation? He says, what will happen to you? I'm worried about you. I'm responsible for you. I'm your wali. I'm your leader. What will happen to you? Then the wife says, may Allah bless that wife. If you don't go to serve your imam, then let me go to serve my imam. Habib says, no, that's enough. That's all I wanted to hear. That's enough. Habib then summons his servant. Says, in the outskirts of Kufa, in the middle of the night, take my horse, I'll meet you there at Fulan time. I'll ride the horse towards Karbala to meet my Mawla. The servant takes the horse in the middle of the night at that location. Habib is a little bit delayed. And the servant begins to talk to the horse. And the servant says that I know that the servant has no business riding the horse of the master. But if my master Habib doesn't show up, if my master Habib is lost, if my master Habib gets caught and in prison, then I'm going to break all the rules, climb upon you, and I ask you to what? Take me to Hussein in Karbala. Habib hears this and says, I had no idea you had love for my Mawla. With that love, I give you azadi. I give you freedom. He says, Habib, with all due respect, up until now, I've served you and your family. Now that you're going to Hussein, you're going to free me. The day of Ashura arrives. With every arrival of the army from Kufa, Bibi Zainab in the tent could hear takbir from that side of the desert. And she would ask, Fizza, what's this takbir? She would go out and go back, Shahzadi, the army has arrived from Kufa, from Sham, from Kufa, from Sham. Imam Hussein is handing out alams to all of his major warriors. There's 12 alams. After the 11th alam, he holds on to the 12th one. A man comes to Imam Hussein, says, Mawla, I didn't get an alam. It's okay if I hold one of those flags? He says, no, this alam is for my Habib. I wrote a letter to Habib. Habib is on his way. Habib will come. Until there came that fateful moment that from the distance somebody reports to Imam Hussein that from Kufa there's a horse coming and a man is riding. Everyone gathers. Habib comes closer. Habib arrives in Karbala, dismounts from the horse, falls at the khak of Imam Hussein. Imam Hussein picks up Habib, kisses him, hugs him. Can you imagine Imam Hussein? His childhood friend is now with him. For the first time now, the takbir is heard from the camp of Imam Hussein. Bibi Zainab in the tent says, Fizza, what's happening? She says, Shahzadi, Habib has arrived. Habib has arrived. Habib is here. Zainab says, Fizza, go to Habib and tell Habib that Zainab sends her salams. Fizza goes out. Hey, Habib, the daughter of Fatima sends her salams to you. Habib falls on the khak, picks up the Karbala khak. Hey, Allah, what moment has come on the Bani Hashim that Zainab al-Kubra is sending her salams? Matam ya Hussein, ya Hussein, ya Hussein.